Hey, welcome to the third episode on Java Modularity. This time I will show you how you can keep the compile class path of each of your modules small and manageable. Last time we learned that you have multiple class paths in a modularized project, because each module has its own compile class path. This helps you conceptually to enforce a certain architecture or structure in your software, so that if you work on a certain module, you only see the code you are supposed to use in this place, and you can't accidentally access code from places that are not related to the module you are working on. Technically, there is also an advantage to not let the compile class paths of your modules explode, because if they grow very large, it will have a performance impact on both Gradle, that analyzes the class paths for up-to-date checking and incremental compilation, or the Java compiler itself, that loads the classes from the compile class path during compilation into memory. As we saw in the example last time, if something is completely missing from a class path, the compiler will complain because it can't compile without the required dependencies. But what about the other way around? What if there are things on your class path that are not used at all during compilation? The compiler or Gradle's Java plugin won't tell you about this. Luckily, there's a great community plugin, the dependency analysis plugin, that you can use for this purpose. Let's first go back to the example we built up last time. If you watched the video, you may remember that I didn't use Gradle's Java plugins, but registered Java compile tasks directly and also created configurations for the compile and runtime class paths to show how Gradle connects to the Java compiler and the Java tool. Now it's time to use the real plugins, which essentially do the same as we have done step by step in the previous two videos. So I changed the setup of the example project now to use a build logic build for convention plugins. If you don't know what a convention plugin is, check out my video on plugins and other related entries in this series. In the build logic build, I defined three convention plugins. A base plugin, where I configure common things like the Java version we want to use in all of our modules, and a library convention plugin for Java library project, and an application convention plugin for Java application projects. The convention plugins combine Gradle's Java plugins like Java library and application with our own conventions like the Java version on top. In the build Gradle files of our two example modules, module and app, I now use the module and application convention plugins respectively. And by this, I get the functionality to compile, test, and run Java code through Gradle. The example code and the declared dependencies are similar to what we had in the example last time already. So the project and the dependencies are in quite good shape right now. Now imagine we continue working our code. One thing we used in our example module code is the MimeType class from the JavaX activation library. We not only use this class internally, but have it on the public API of our module code. That's why we defined this as an API dependency in the build Gradle file. Now imagine that we work on the code and remove this MIME type from the public API, which could be a good structural improvement as we now have a cleaner API that only contains our own types. With this change, we should also change the dependency from API to implementation in the build Gradle file. But now imagine that you not only have these two dependencies, but much more in the build Gradle file, which is more realistic for real enterprise projects. In this case, it's easy to forget to make such a change or to even see that such change is possible. To keep this under control, you need some tool support, and this is where you should use the dependency analysis plugin. Let's add the plugin to our build. Since the plugin is a community plugin, we need to add a dependency to it in the build Gradle file of our build logic build. Here we also define which version of the plugin we want to use. Once this is done, we can apply the plugin in our convention plugins. One specialty about this plugin is that it is applied in the root project and not individually in each subproject as you would usually do with most plugins. So what we do is we add an additional convention plugin for the root, and the only thing we do in there for now is applying the dependency analysis plugin. And to use the root convention plugin, we add a build Gradle file to the root of our project, so next to the settings Gradle file, and apply the root convention plugin there. Doing this won't change anything about your normal build process. The dependency analysis plugin only adds analysis tasks or help tasks, if you will, on top of what the Java plugins and Gradle itself provides. If you do a normal build or compilation or testing, the analysis plugin wouldn't influence that at all. Only when you call a task directly from the analysis plugin, you will get certain analysis results. Let's have a look at the tasks available in our projects. Let's look at the module project first. You can now see in the task list that there are dependency analysis tasks. The probably most important one is the project health task here, which analyzes the Java classes in your project and the classes in the dependencies, and then tells you if the dependencies and their scopes match what can be found in the code. So if we run the project health task now for our module project, it tells us that the scope of the activation dependency should be changed from API to implementation. This is because we removed it now from all the public API in our source code. And if we run the task again, it won't report this issue anymore. It also works the other way around. For example, let's put a class from Commons.io on the public API. If we run the analysis again, it tells us that now the dependency to Commons.io should be changed from implementation to API. Another, and maybe the most important case, is when we stop using a dependency at all. We might not recognize that if the usage is scattered over many classes in our module. In our example, we remove all references to Commons.io. So now we won't need this utility library anymore. And the dependency analysis plugin tells us that this dependency, the one to Commons.io, can now be removed. Let's get the code and the dependencies of our module project back to where they were in the beginning and have a look at some more cases in the app project. In the app project, we haven't declared a dependency to JavaX Activation, but we can still see this dependency because it's transitively available through the module, as it is an API dependency. For more discussion on this, see the previous video. As I said there, if you still use this dependency directly in the code, as we do here, it should still be declared as a dependency. Although this technically doesn't change the class path, as the jar is only there once, no matter how often the dependency is declared, it conceptually makes things cleaner, because you explicitly state what your module is using directly. But the compiler won't tell you this, because the JavaX Activation jar is on the class path, and so the compiler can compile the code. The dependency analysis plugin, however, if we now run the project health task for the app project, can tell us that we are using classes from JavaX Activation directly in our module, but haven't declared a dependency to it. And similar the other way around, as we've seen before, it would also tell us if the dependency could be removed because we don't use classes directly. Another special case are runtime-only dependencies. So here in the example, we have a dependency to the SLF4j API, and we have a dependency to a logger implementation. SLF4j is simple. The implementation is not needed at compilation time because it's only plugged in at runtime. That's why it's declared runtime only here. But it's easy to get this wrong and declare such dependencies as implementation instead. Because again, the compiler won't tell you that you have too much jars on your compile class path. If I change the SLF4j simple dependency here to implementation, the dependency analysis plugin tells us that this can be removed or changed to runtime only. Whether you remove a dependency or change it to runtime only is something you need to know based on what the dependency is for. The plugin can't tell you this because it's a static analysis done at build time, which does know nothing about the runtime behavior of jars, which might load other classes via reflection or service loaders. Ideally, you would have a test that checks if an expected runtime-only dependency is actually there at runtime, so that if we would remove the dependency completely, we would see that through a failing test. Using the dependency analysis plugin, you can keep your compile class paths small. If you start using the plugin on an existing project, you might still have a lot of dependencies. But now, with the plugin as a tool to help you, you know that the dependencies you have are actually used, And then if you see dependencies which you think should not be there, you can investigate, can remove them and see which compilation breaks, and then start refactoring your code, for example, to remove external types from your own API. What I showed you might already be enough to use a plugin in your project. You might not need any additional configuration or customization. But the plugin offers a lot here if you need a more customized setup. Let's have a quick look. One thing to mention is that there is a build health task on the root project. Running that task will give you a complete list of all issues found in all of your subprojects. Then, if we look at the task list for one of the subprojects, you can see that there are some more tasks that give you some more details about the analysis. For example, there's a reasons task that tells you more about how the plugin came to the conclusion to give you a certain advice for a certain dependency. There's also the fixed dependencies task that can rewrite build files to automatically apply all the advices. The plugin also allows you to configure certain details. There is the dependency analysis extension for that. You can use it, for example, to exclude certain classes that you consider internal from the public API analysis. If that isn't enough for you, the plugin also allows you to add your own tasks. It offers a hook for so-called post-processing tasks. These are tasks of type abstract post-processing task that you extend with your own do-last action. Here you get access to the analysis result, which we saw printed on the console or in the report, and do your own processing with that. You can use that, for example, to create your own reporting with more concrete advices that match the structure and architecture of your project. And you can decide how you want to handle certain analysis results. For example, you can make certain results fail the build or you ignore other results completely. This could be used, for example, to set up a customized dependency analysis check that runs for every PR build and gives feedback or even fails the build if dependencies are not correctly updated following the code changes of a PR. The dependency analysis plugin that I introduced in this video is a great addition to Gradle. It is a tool to keep your compile class passes cleaned up and minimal. As Gradle Core doesn't offer any functionality for this, this community plugin is almost a must-have addition for any larger Java project. Cheers to Tony, who is actively developing and improving this plugin for years. When you have your compile class passes cleaned up to only contain the entries that are actually needed, you may still have some issues, mainly conflicting classes and security vulnerabilities in external libraries you are using. We'll talk about these two topics in the next videos. See you then, and please subscribe to this channel if you haven't done so already.